Stephen. Into the Storm follows three separate groups of people caught up in a storm across a single day. What was it about the use of these different viewpoints that appealed to you about John Swetnam's script, and how taken were you with the idea of a found footage style disaster movie?
Well, first off, I love the challenge of how do you make a movie with these points of views, and also I loved having a diverse group of people that then come together and sort of persevere and survive this, you know, unbelievable experience. Because often in reality, you know, when people survive this enormous disaster, they bond in a different way and have an idea of what's really important in life. And so it was just a great challenge to deal with all that stuff. Had I known how difficult it was going to be when I said yes to it, then maybe I would have not been so quick to say yes. But I thought it was great, and I had a fun time, and it was just really exciting to do.
As you know, in Britain, we don't really get these kinds of weather fronts crossing our shores. But I wondered whether you have any experience with this kind of thing. Did you go tornado hunting yourself as research?
Well, when I grew up in the Midwest, and I actually experienced some tornadoes, not firsthand, but they had tornado warnings, which means a tornado was within 15 miles of our community, and so I had to go in the basement and wait for it to come, and then it was that sort of anticipation of whether or not it's going to actually hit or not that gives you that tension and uncertain and uneasiness as a young kid. So I've had that experience firsthand.
I gather you had a kind of challenging job making what was hot summertime America look like a storm was about to hit, including using large canvases to block out the sun. Talk us through the logistics of these kind of in-camera effects.
Well, the challenge for something like Into the Storm is trying to make it real and believable. And we have these cameras, and it's handheld, so it's trying to look very sort of organic. But you have to pre-plan everything. So you have to have huge construction cranes. You have giant water rain towers, all this stuff that takes hours to set up, and then you're trying to make it feel like you just happen to be running around in the moment. That's a big challenge, and you know, fortunately the crew was fantastic, and we managed to accomplish that, but it's not an easy task.
And of course there is some CGI in the film as well, and you're no stranger to that, having worked extensively with James Cameron on some pretty huge movies. How naturally does that side of thing come to you now, and what were the challenges with Into the Storm?
Well, the challenges for me for Into the Storm, for the visual effects, were we're dealing with real natural phenomena that people have seen hundreds, if not thousands, of photos and videos, so we have perfect reference. So I would show the reference of YouTube tornadoes to the effects companies and say, this is what it looks like. There is no question. It has to look exactly like this, and it's really challenging from a digital standpoint to get those simulations to look like natural phenomenon, and so it's just a lot of work back and forth, because unlike a science fiction movie where you have spectacle, spaceships, and surreal things, this is all based on reality, so it has to feel realistic. You know, trees blowing, you may not even notice it, but there's thousands of trees in this movie that are digital trees blowing in the wind.
I wanted to talk about sound as well, as a bit of a sound nerd myself. I saw it in Dolby Atmos, which I thought sounded amazing. It gives it real weight and power to the visuals. How important is sound for you, and to what extent would you encourage people to go and try and see it in Dolby Atmos?
This movie is meant to be seen in the best quality, largest screen, best sound, Dolby Atmos, because that's what we, you know, intended for. And, you know, having gone to USC Cinema School and really working with a guy named Tom Holman, who invented the THX sound system way back when, I really got into sound as well. And on this film, having Per Hallberg be one of the sound, being the sound supervisor, working with a great team at Warner Brothers, we were able to bring the sound to a level of realism. That's the thing I strive for. It is I didn't want, you know, augmented sounds with lion roars and other things that make it sort of larger than life. I wanted to feel believable and realistic and powerful. And sound is amazing. I think sound is 50% of a movie. And so I think this movie is not meant to be seen on an iPhone. It's meant to be seen on the big screen, big crowd, and you get to go see it with your date and hold on and experience the horrific forces.
I have to ask you about working with Brits Richard Armitage and Max Deacon. What made them so perfect for their respective roles? And they nailed their accents.
Yes, well, everybody. And we even had an Aussie as well with Alicia, who had to be American. But for me, Richard Armitage, since it was New Line, you know, I knew that he was in The Hobbit, the first one, before we started filming, and I was really excited of the opportunity and chance to work with Richard. And what I liked about it is he plays such a strong, commanding character in the Hobbit movie. Here, he's just an ordinary guy who's an assistant vice principal trying to deal with the politics of school and people and having two teenagers that are in that awkward, you know, rebellion phase and you know, realizing that's not working, his normal diplomatic ways of dealing with his assistant principal and so forth. So to have him play the ordinary man who suddenly rises up and does the extraordinary thing and cares about his kids, I felt kind of went against his normal type, and I really liked that and what he brought to it. And Max Deacon was wonderful, and they actually have a very similar, they almost look like father-son, you know, as far as physicality and so forth. But Max was just great too, and his accent was flawless, and he brought just a certain naturalism to his performance that I totally bought, you know, which was great.
It's set to be your first feature-length dramatic film as a director that's outside of a pre-established franchise. I wanted to know, was this quite a freeing experience for you in that respect?
Yes, I mean, I loved doing Final Destination 5, and I, you know, had a great time doing it. But this was a chance to start something from the script stage all the way through, and I didn't have preconceived notions or preconceived ideas that I had to follow. And so it was very rewarding and exhilarating to be able to have more authorship to this than a franchise.
And by creating a film in found footage style, it kind of signifies a desire to be realistic. How beneficial is that approach for a film like this?
I'm sorry, repeat that question.
So, creating a film in a found footage style signifies a desire to be realistic. You know, how beneficial is that kind of approach in film into the story?
Well, I think the what I call first-person narrative style of the cameras allowed it to feel more real. Because if you shot this in a traditional method with movie cameras and dollies and steadicams, it would kind of be too artificial. But the little roughness that you get with the first-person narrative found footage allows it to feel organic and real. And so we didn't want to go too far with it, though, because I think found footage movies tend to be so shaky and so distracting that you become obsessed with the technique and not the characters and the film itself. So there's a fine line, and I think we accomplished that with this one.
The film also features a large number of set pieces. How challenging were they to shoot, and can it be intimidating to be in charge of that many people on expensive shots like that?
Yeah, it can be very intimidating, and when you have huge, you know, crews dealing with all this stuff, you know, I have experience dealing with that on these big movies such as Avatar and Titanic and the second unit director, so it wasn't intimidating for me on the respect of dealing with large crews. What was more intimidating is just trying to, you have a vision of what you want to get, and you only have a certain amount of time, and you just have to be efficient with everything. And that's what I've learned over the years, is just to be very smart and efficient with what you do.
I wanted to ask you about the realism factor we talked about earlier. How many weather experts did you have advising you, and was it important for you to keep the science of the film correct?
I wanted the tornadoes to look as realistic as possible, and the great thing is there's lots of visual reference of real tornadoes. There we have so many storm chasers, we have so many just regular people that have photographed and videotaped real tornadoes, that there was a wealth of reference material to look at. At the same time, the physics of how the tornado forms and the forces and all of that, I, you know, got some books and textbooks on tornado phenomena to make sure that I was getting in the ballpark with that. And then the types, and, you know, did we go too far with the sizes or the power of it? And then doing lots of research, and we found it was just the opposite. You know, we finished filming the movie, we had our big climactic end tornado was supposed to be 1 mile wide, and it turns out there was a 2.5 mile wide tornado that touched down a year after we had shot it. So we weren't being too ridiculous in the scope and size.
And finally, Stephen, in a crowded summer blockbuster market, what is it for you about Into the Storm that sets it apart from its competitors?
Well, I think Into the Storm is just one of those movies that you go see it with a date, because it's, you hold on tight, you want somebody that you care about or love, and you experience it together, and it's a fun thrill ride that is intense, but at the same time uplifting at the end.
Stephen Quayle, great speaking.
Thank you. Great job.